On Hot Copy this morning, we talk about agriculture smuggling. Agriculture Assistant Secretary Federico Lasiste Jr. links former government officials to the supposed agri-smuggling in the country. During Monday's Senate hearing, Lasiste said the officials called him up to try and stop him from filing cases against the smugglers. And to talk about this issue, we have former Agriculture Secretary Manny Piñol, who is also running for senator in the upcoming polls. Mr. Piñol, good morning to you, sir.
Karen, good morning.
All right. You were once Agriculture Secretary. Bakit po ba hindi mahinto ang agricultural smuggling sa Pilipinas?
Well, agricultural smuggling or any other smuggling activity for that matter will continue for as long as we have not improved our customs inspection facilities, for as long as the price of smuggled goods is lower than what we produce locally. So this is an institutional problem, actually, that could be solved by, number one, improving the capability of our customs bureau to check on incoming cargoes. And that could only be solved if we digitalize the customs operations para wala nang involvement yung mga tao sa pag-check-in or pag-check ng mga incoming cargoes. Number two, we have to improve our local marketing system. Kasi actually, Karen, yung sinasabi nila na kaya sila nag-smuggle dahil mas mura ang imported kasi local. Actually, hindi totoo yun eh. Because mas mura actually ang local na gulay kaysa imported na gulay at masariwa. Kanya lang, our problem in the country is our marketing system, where from the farm gate to the kitchen of the Filipino families, mga 10 kamay ang dinadaanan ng ating mga produkto.
Okay.
So while carrots actually are sold for only 10 pesos in Bukidnon, pagdating sa kusina ng Pilipinong pamilya, umaabot na 100.
Okay, all right.
So these are the institutional problems, actually.
Okay, those are the institutional structural issues that you believe should be changed. But let's start with the basics first. See, Agriculture Assistant Secretary Federico Lasiste is linking former government officials behind the smuggling for agri-products. You were once agri-secretary. Are there officials involved in smuggling?
I don't know how they do things right now, but during your time,
we
were actually very active in our campaign against agricultural smuggling during
but
my
were
time.
There officials involved?
You know, if we talk about officials involved, talaga namang official ng gobyerno may involved dyan. Sino ba may involved sa smuggling kundi official ng gobyerno? Either customs, but to point at the Department of Agriculture as one of the participants in the smuggling is not quite right. Because in the first place, smuggling occurs in the ports. Pwede lang lubusot yan kapag pinalusot ng Bureau of Customs. The worst thing that could be done by agriculture officials would be siguro facilitating the documents in the entry of illegal goods, no? But that's how far they could go.
Mm-mm.
I don't know. Siguro mas mabuti siguro kung pangalanan ni Asek Lasiste, yung sinasabi niyang former. Bakit former? Anong pakialam ng mga former officials sa smuggling? They don't have the power anymore to influence the activities in the ports or in the issuances of permits. That could only be done by incumbent officials right now.
Okay, now Senate President Tito Soto says it's time to crack the whip with Customs and the Department of Agriculture. Even during your time when you were Agri-Secretary, do you believe Customs is and was doing its job?
Well, yes, I worked closely with the then Customs Commissioner Sid La Peña. In fact, we conducted the operations together and wala naman akong nakitang connivance on the part of the top officials of the Bureau of Customs doon sa operation sa mga smugglers. Kanya lang, ang problema nga doon ay nakakalusot yung ibang mga kargamento through a technicality. Kasi lahat ng mga containers na yan dumadaan sa X-ray. Kanya lang yung X-ray nila, hindi masyadong upgraded to the point na yung sibuyas na hugis ng sibuyas na bilog, napagpagkamalan na hugis ng apple. So nakakalusot. And sabi ko nga, we really have to improve on our customs facilities and even the X-ray facilities at customs to be able to prevent this. The other action that could be done actually, kasi ang problema natin dyan, may makakalusot talaga eh. The other action that could be done actually, and this could be done right now to discourage smugglers, is to institute a market denial campaign. Ang ibig sabihin, dapat yung ating mga enforcement agencies, and this could be still under the Bureau of Customs, should monitor the markets for smuggled goods. At hindi payagang maibenta ito, because if you allow smuggled goods to be sold in the market, it's effectively allowing smugglers to continue the operations. In fact, I suggested this, at ang sagot ng iba ay kawawa naman yung mga nagbebenta. But you know, that does not justify the action. Sapagkat kung ganyan ang ating line of reasoning, then ano ang kaibahan niyan doon sa mga nagnanakaw at binibenta pagkatapos? Kawawa din yung mga pinagbibentahan ng magnanakaw. Ganun ba ang ating pananaw dyan? So ang pinaka-immediate dyan dapat is kung hindi mapigil sa ports, then check the market. And I know open ngayon sa brazen yung bintahan ng mga smuggled vegetables in Divisoria and other markets. In fact, nagkasabi nga sa akin yung mga tao, sir, open na open. No? Now, let me just point out one little problem here, Karen, no? And many people do not see this. Tingnan niyo yung food safety aspect nitong mga smuggled goods na ito, mga smuggled vegetable products. Yung carrots, for example, isang buwan na hindi pa nabubulok. There's something wrong with it, no? It could have preservatives. Now that's not gonna be good for the health of our people. And in this aspect, dapat pumasok na rin yung ating Department of Health and the FDA to check on the quality of these vegetables.
But Mr. Piñol, for this to, you said, be as open and brazen as it is today, it means it's being allowed by government.
Oh yes, open naman.
So which agency is accountable?
Well, number one, of course, Bureau of Customs, because you're supposed to run after smuggled items. You're not supposed to allow these smuggled items to be sold in the market. That's still part of the smuggling operations. Second, dapat siguro makialam na rin yung ating Department of Health, because I'm really concerned, no? Paano nyo na ba preserve yung mga gulay na isang buwan na nasa display, hindi pa nabubulok? Samantalang yung mga local natin na gulay na nasa Riwa, after about a week ay malalanta na yung carrots. Yung carrots na galing sa China, mag-iisang buwan na makinis pa rin at makintaw. So ako, looking at it as a farmer, nagugulat ako. And I would assume that there are preservatives being used to lengthen the shelf life of these products. And this is an issue that involves health. And so this is an issue that I think the DOH or even the local government unit should look into.
Okay. Now, even during your term as Agriculture Secretary, in August 2018, you faced the Senate and you were also criticized for not doing enough to curb rice smuggling. It was rice smuggling then, which affected rice prices in Zamboanga. And you had several suggestions to curb smuggling in Zamboanga then. But during that particular time, what were your own challenges as Agriculture Secretary?
Well, number one, rice smuggling actually occurs in the southern part of the Philippines. That's an open secret. And you know why? Because the islands, Tawi-Tawi, Sulu, and Basilan, do not produce rice for themselves. And since malapit sila sa Sabah, madaling makakatawid yung mga bigas from Vietnam, binababa sa Sabah, tinatawid sa kanila. That's the reason why when I was Agriculture Secretary, I suggested that there should be a parang trading post for rice coming in.
Yeah.
And impose levy and taxes on these rice imports para matigil yung smuggling na yan at para makakolekta tayo ng tariff and taxes. That was the most practical thing to do. Now, the smuggling of rice actually was not a major issue during my time as Secretary of Agriculture because at that time, nagpo-produce na tayo ng mataas na volume ng rice. In fact, we achieved the highest rice harvest pre-RTL in 2017, the highest in the history of the country. And we were nearing our rice sufficiency target. Kanya lang, nagkaroon ng artificial rice shortage in 2018. The NFA Council did not allow NFA to import the NFA rice sold in the market for 27 pesos. Kaya nung mawala yung 27 pesos na bigas sa merkado, biglang binaniobra ng rice cartel yung presyo ng available na bigas. And they actually increased the prices to as much as about 80 pesos per kilo.
Okay, yeah.
At tinawag nilang rice crisis yun. It was not a rice shortage because kung may pera ka, may mabibili ka.
Okay.
But I would suspect now, this point in time, Karen, looking back, tingin ko part yun ng drama para ma-justify yung implementation ng rice tariffication law. No? They created an artificial shortage para sabihin sa presidente na look, we really have to allow the entry of so much imported rice. Ang kanilang word na ginamit is unimpeded importation of rice, which is now causing a lot of difficulties and hardships on our rice farmers.
Mm-mm. Okay, very interesting points you mentioned there. Going back to that, you did suggest a rice trading center in 2018 and to tax the entry of smuggled rice, right? But then this fell on deaf ears. The president did not listen to it, did not accede to your suggestion.
Well, you know, hindi lang naman kasi akong nagsasuggest sa presidente. You have to contend with the economic managers who have a different perspective of things. In fact, yun ang pinagtalunan namin, yung rice tariffication was one of the issues that placed me at odds with the economic managers actually. I was not against importation, but I was for managed importation. Ibig sabihin, kung ano lang yung gulang natin, yun lang i-import natin. Kasi you also have to understand that we have local farmers whose lives will be affected if we flood the market with imported rice.
Yeah.
Now, ang pangako nila noon when they allowed RTL to be passed and signed by the president, ang pangako nila sa presidente was, if you sign this, there will be a reduction of 7 pesos in the price of rice in the market. That did not happen.
Yeah.
They also promised that the lives of the Philippine rice farmers would improve because there will be assistance coming from the tariff. That did not happen because bumagsak ang presyo ng palay from about 20 to 22 pesos per kilo during my time to only about 10 to 12 pesos right now. And ang double whammy dyan, Karen, is the fact that the cost of fertilizer has tripled over the last 2 years.
Okay, now, Mr. Piñol, so if you win a Senate seat, some points, you mentioned about the creation of an artificial rice shortage in 2018 and the NFA being unable to import rice, right? That could have stabilized the prices. How would you change the NFA's mandate? Would you, and do we still need the NFA?
We will have to bring back the NFA into the picture, Karen. I cannot understand why a very important commodity like rice would be given to a private sector. Na alam naman natin from the very beginning na itong sector na ito ay rice cartel. They connive among themselves on how much the price of rice would be in the market today. They connive among themselves kung ilang anong volume ang pwedeng i-release sa merkado. They connive among themselves kung ano ang i-import. And they also connive among themselves kung magkano ang presyo ng palay ng magsasaka. So we really have to correct this because without NFA, walang supervisory at saka regulatory authority ang government over a very important commodity like rice.
Okay, another question is, would you amend the rice tariffication law or completely ask that it be cancelled, so to speak? Or is there a specific amendment that can be done with a rice tariffication law that you feel would still protect local producers?
Oh, yes. In fact, I'm happy that even the authors of the rice tariffication law, and I would like to refer to Sherwin Katsalyan, who was one of the authors of the rice tariffication law, now admits that the law is flawed. And he even suggested that it should be reviewed and amended. At ang statement na yan actually vindicates me, because I've been saying all along, hey, the intention is good, the intention is noble, bring down the price of rice in the market, improve the lives of the Filipino farmers. But since that did not happen, why don't we review the law and correct the flaws in the law, amendments in the law? And there's a long list of amendments that should be done. Hindi naman natin pwedeng tanggalin yan as a law, because meron tayong commitment sa World Trade Organization to allow imported rice to come in. But then again, that commitment does not prevent us from also ensuring that the welfare of our rice farmers and our rice consumers as well are protected. No? And this is where the amendments would come in essence.
Okay. And what about the Anti-Agricultural Smuggling Act? This is Republic Act 10845. The weakness of this particular law, ever since it's been passed, not one smuggler has been convicted, despite billions of pesos worth of agricultural products already being seized by the Bureau of Customs through the years. What is the problem with that law?
Correct. That law is supposed to stop an activity which could actually be stopped if we produce better quality and lower priced goods. And our problem in the Philippines actually, Karen, as I've mentioned earlier, hindi naman mahal yung ating produkto. Kanya lang, from, yung sabi ko kanina, from the farm gate to the market, mga 10 kamay ng middlemen ang dinadaanan eh. That's why one of my advocacies actually is to correct our marketing system. Dapat pakialaman talaga ng gobyerno yung pagbibili ng produkto ng ating mga magsasaka, so that they could be guided on what products to produce that would provide nutrition for our people and at the same time provide supplies for the market. Kasi ang problema natin sa Pilipinas is the fact that we are a geographically fragmented country, 7,000 islands. Did you know that it's more expensive to bring bananas from Mindanao to Manila than to ship bananas from Davao to Japan? Ganun kahirap. Kaya tumataas yung presyo natin. So kailangan talagang i-expand natin yung Food Terminal Incorporated. It's an existing government corporation na hindi lang pinabayaan lang, no? A victim of politics actually. Pati ang NFA should be brought back into the picture. We could establish buying stations of agricultural products needed by the market in key production areas and let government handle this. Alam mo, I'll give you an example. Right now, as we speak, I'm in Zamboanga City, by the way.
Okay.
In Zamboanga right now, sa Zamboanga del Norte, ang presyo ng tamban is 5 pesos per kilo.
Okay.
At alam ko, magtutulo ang laway ng taga Manila niyan. But how do we bring the tamban to Manila at that price? Unless makialam ang gobyerno at merong mga cold storage facilities, merong mga reefer vans na magdadala nito sa mga key urban areas, talagang hindi nyo matitikman yung ganyang presyo. And only government can do it. No? The private sector cannot possibly get into that picture because maraming mga factors na magkukos ng kanilang kalugian. No?
So what would you do, Mr. Piñol, if you become a senator?
Yes.
Frankly speaking, there was a slight increase in the budget with the Department of Agriculture for 2022, but it's nothing close to, let's say, what the DPWH is getting or even other agencies in government. We often say that we prioritize on agriculture. Candidates often say, I'll prioritize on agriculture. But when it hits the budget, frankly speaking, you have agri that's had very dismal growth this 2022. I think at one point they were even giving Agri 94 billion pesos, and the request of Secretary Dar was, I think, double than that.
He actually got a better deal. When I was Secretary of Agriculture, I was only getting 49 to 50 billion pesos. Mm. That in spite of the public statement of the president directed at the economic managers to increase the budget for agriculture. You know, I believe that agriculture in any country should get a bigger share of the budget. Kasi alam mo, pag kakapusin tayo ng pagkain, mahihirapan tayo. Mm. Pwede tayong mag-survive na sira-sira yung kalsada natin. Pwede tayong mag-survive na wala tayong mga classrooms. But this country cannot survive. We don't have food. So hindi ko naman sinasabing bigyan ng pinakamalaking budget. But agriculture and fishery should be placed in the top three actually of our budgetary priorities. Mm. And that is what I am going to fight for. Should I be given a chance and the opportunity of working as Senator of this Republic.
Okay, now let's move to politics a bit. With presidential aspirant Ping Lacson already resigning from Partido Reforma, how does this affect your whole campaign?
My campaign, you mean? Yeah. I am still with Ping Lacson. In fact, I'm joining him today here in Zamboanga City.
Would it be more difficult, of course, because he is now running as an independent?
Yes, it's difficult. Kulang sa pondo, kulang sa, of course, sa network sa baba. Mm-hmm. But, you know, ang paniwala ko kasi sa politika, Karen, it's not really actually joining who's leading him. It's actually joining who's on the right track. No? And I believe in the anti-corruption policy of Ping Lacson. Whether he wins or loses this election, I don't really care. It doesn't really matter to me. Para sa akin, yung tamang sasamahan, yun ang sasamahan ko. Kasi kung puro na lang tayo kung sino yung leading doon tayo, abay saan tayo pupulutin?
Mm. And you believe that's what many local officials are doing now? Because left and right, of course, well, you do have different local officials already proclaiming openly their support for UNITIM and some already for the Vice President.
Well, actually, wala naman akong problema doon, no? But etong ganitong trending actually sa Philippine politics, I think, is somewhat destructive to the manifestation of the free will of the people. Alam mo naman yung psyche ng Pilipino, kung sinong lamang doon sa sama. Mm. Kanya ako, tingin ko dapat itong ginagawang mga public surveys by every Tom, Dick, and Harry published actually should be regulated later on. Hindi naman pwedeng puro na lang survey, ito si ganito leading. Because alam niyo naman ang mentality ng Pilipino eh. Mm-hmm. Kung sinong leading, doon sasama. Regardless of whether the leader has the right program for our country or not. No? So it actually makes the battlefield tilted heavily in favor of those identified the survey firms as leading in the surveys. Mm. And sa tingin ko, no, although of course ako kasali din ako sa biktima niyan and I might be issuing a self-serving statement, pero tingin ko dapat itong surveys na pinapublish showing who's leading and who's not, no, should be regulated later on because mm-hmm. it affects the winning chances of the other candidates.
Uh-oh.
Kasi so, number one, hindi lang yung popular support, yung tatawag lang bandwagon effect, pati yung financial support. Kasi mm-hmm. you have to understand, yung mga supporters sa finances would also put in their money on the winning horse.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
kapag ikaw ay nakikitang consistent na kulelat ka sa survey, talagang walang mabibigay ng pondo sa'yo at tutulong sa'yo. So unfair yun para sa mga...
But how would you regulate that? Wouldn't that be an abridgment to free speech, frankly? Because these survey firms, they do...
Kasi ang free speech naman, hindi absolute. Eh. If you're peddling wrong data with the purpose of influencing the mind of the people, that's not free speech.
But then that's the presumption, it's wrong data. But then you'll have SWS and Pulse Asia and these institutional survey firms argue that it's a scientific method that's used worldwide. I'm just curious, you know, how you want to implement this.
Hindi naman natin sinasabing huwag mag-survey. Mm. Pero sinasabi natin, huwag yung kung sino-sino lang gumagawa ng survey.
Mm.
Let's do a scientific survey, that's okay. Pero you have to understand, Karen, that in the history of polling actually, hindi foolproof yan. Ha?
Mm.
You remember that case in the US where because of the polling projection. May isang diaryo na naglabas na may isang presidente na nanalo na pagka pinabukasan iba ang lumabas, no? So hindi foolproof yan. At ang effect nito actually doon sa mind conditioning actually is something that actually scares me, you know?
Okay, so the Senate will be conducting another hearing. What do you believe should senators focus on? I mean, considering if you were there, so that the problem of smuggling, whether it's rice or vegetables or different kind of fruits, would already there would be a systemic change.
Actually, we should focus on institutional reforms rather than temporary actions. Kasi yung imbestiga kung sinong involved, imbestiga kung sinong agency ang culprit. These are actually temporary solutions. We should look at institutional reforms. Mm-hmm. Like sabi ko, let's digitalize the whole customs operations. Number two, let's correct our marketing system so that the products of our farmers could compete price-wise with imported goods. Because for as long as imported goods are cheaper than our local products, there will always be attempts to smuggle in those products, regardless of what we do.
On that note, Mr. Manny Piñol, thank you for joining me today, and good luck to you, sir.
Thank you very much.